one Genesis Rider here with another Genesis Tips and Tricks video. Today we'll be looking at some big team battle snipers on the map Ragnarok. I was playing with some of my friends here, specifically Bullet Rebel, Trevin Rubin, Mojo Walker, Daniel Starling, Poopy Pants, Jay Kudo, and other people of that nature. Even the professor was hanging out with us as well, so shout out to them. I'm going to pause right here for just a second, and I want to... The reason for this is because typically when you go out the front of the lift, you want to pause for about half a second before you go out the front of the lift in snipers, because you want to lift right as the enemy team is lifting, and oftentimes if the enemy team is not sprinting, they won't reach their lift as fast. But you can look, and as you're at the very top of your lift, let's pretend I'm in the lift, and I'm exiting it, you can see their head at the very top above this rock, okay? Now, oftentimes enemy players, as you can see here, will use other routes to get out of their base, and that's unfortunately what ends up happening here as I lift out the front of our base. I was pretty warmed up for this game. I will have to say my shots are pretty on point. And I would like to point out some overall general strategies for holding machine gun turret rock on Ragnarok. Now, what I want you to understand here, a lot happens at the beginning of this film, and it slows down a little bit later on, so I'll really go carefully over this. You can see I know this player is charging out from the water cave. So even though I know this player is there, I'm still going to use my angles. I'm going to check the side of their water cave, center their water cave, and then check their base right as I come back to the back of machine gun turret. And that's always what you want to be doing, is checking angles before you jump out. So here, I check the side of their water cave, pick up the kill, check their water cave, and then keep moving on. Check their saw cave, or their side saw cave, and get a quick shot on that guy. And I know this guy's crouched somewhere over here, but unfortunately the large amount of time I zoom allows this enemy player to push up, and you have to realize there's no radar in big team battle snipers, so I do end up unfortunately being killed here. It's just kind of funny because you can see on my HUD there, literally all my teammates were top middle, so I at that point in the film I actually call out to my teammates, hey, he's top middle, why didn't you kill him? But anyway, I got killed off there, that's okay. I'm going to respawn near the entrance to our shotgun cave. Just to let you guys know, this is called their, I call this their saw cave, because normally in big team battle the saw spawns right here beside the cave. In on Valhalla, the original creation of this map in Halo 3, this was called shotgun cave because a shotgun would spawn in this general area. And you can call this side our shotgun cave as well, or pelican cave, however you want to put it. So right here I'm going to rush towards machine gun turret again. The reason being is because the machine gun turret spawns right there. And I'm just going to check my angles again. You can see I'm checking the side of their water cave, checking the center of their water cave, and I would like to point out a few general things here. The overall strategy for Ragnarok is that you want to be holding top center as well as one or two of the sides being machine gun turret and pelican. Now, when you're blue team, as you can see that I am here, it is less optimal to hold pelican because you don't have as much angles in the enemy base. As you can see here, there's only a small window where you can shoot at the enemy base. If you were red team and you pushed up to the pelican, you got on the pelican, you can see there's just a huge amount of space to look at on the enemy side blue base. So pelican is much more advantageous when you are red team. But when you're blue team, the place you want to really, really be holding down and locking down a lot is machine gun turret, simply because it has a lot of angles on the enemy base. If you're red team and you're pushing up to machine gun turret, while there are lots of angles to shoot at, you have this very, very easy angle to get sniped from, and that is the flat rock. You never know when someone's just going to pop up and look at you and snipe you and then back down again. Whereas on this side, it's much more easy to spot players spawning in beside their saw cave, and that's what I'm trying to attempt to do here. If you are controlling top middle and machine gun turret, and let's say you've killed three or four of them off of this side, okay? Typically they spawn over here in the backs of their base or over here by water cave, okay? Those are the three general spawn points. If you kill three or four of them off in this area by their saw cave, they're likely to spawn back at their base or in water cave. And I'll point some of the spawnings later out to you guys. Now, this is a very, very common tactic right here, and this is one of the reasons why, again, pelican is not as advantageous from blue side, because red team can get up on this little shelf and easily snipe people on the pelican from a very long distance. Likewise, there is a similar position on this side of the map that I know you guys are probably very familiar with, where blue team can get up on this shelf. If you just jump up these rocks right here, you can sort of get up on this shelf and be kind of looking at pelican across the map. It's not as advantageous of a position because of the trees, but that's just how it generally works out. So moving on to the gameplay, I hope that gave you a brief description there. I'm watching this back spawn of their base by their cave rocks, their side rocks there. It's just a little rock formation to the right of their base from our perspective. And I see that some people spawn here. And I'm not only just being aware of spawning in general, but I'm also being aware of where people's heads are going to pop out, okay? And so if people spawn here, their first instinct is going to be come over here and zoom and look where you are going to be. So I'm going to try to be aiming on the same angle as their head. You can see I get a kill here and unfortunately get cleaned up by that second player. I'm always aiming where their heads are going to be, and right now what I'm doing is a very precarious position. While I do pick up one kill, try to hit that guy very quickly who just lifted out of their side. This is a very precarious position, mainly because of these two positions on the map. And I'm just going to show you this once during the film, and I'll call out later when I get killed from this position again. But essentially, people will do this and will push up on this little ledge here, and it's very difficult to see them because they can literally just poke out and shoot you, and it's very difficult to see them completely. Likewise on the same side. So holding top center is really not necessarily an advantageous position because you can get easily sniped, as you see I do from that player I just showed you there in the enemy base. So seeing that I only got one killer, I'm going to stay here on machine gun turret. I'm watching their salt cave because I see my teammate just died there, and I've been looking behind their base. Now this is not a great angle to snipe from, but I do pick up a kill, and I think that was a body shot assist off one of my teammates' kills there. Now I want to go over a few sniper tips here, okay? It is pretty simple to snipe in this game compared to previous Halo games, but there are some basics that I should go over. For example, right here, I'm just trying to line myself up with the heads of these players. So for example, right here, you can see me slowly. Okay, I move to the right, and now I'm on an even level with this player's head. All I'm going to do is move to the right or move to the left with my reticle and fire. I'm just making and then notice how I do the exact same thing again. Move over and then try to get the headshot again. And I'll slow some of my other snipes down so you guys can see how I'm playing this. Now, it's unadvisable to whip scope like this unless you're warmed up or unless your reticle is very close to the enemy player. You do not want to be whip scoping when you're double zooming. In other words, when you've zoomed twice, okay? Right here on Ragnarok, I mainly just zoom once. I rarely zoom twice because the 8x optical zoom when you zoom twice is just really overkill. It's not enough. As you can see, I'd really just skip past that second zoom option when I'm zooming down with my sniper rifle. So right here, I'm zooming once, catch that player, and shoot him. Now, that was really, really fast what just happened there. So let me slow it down here and give you a little bit of perspective on what happened here. Get back to this little snipe here. I'm in the water. I'm looking down their water cave, and I can see that this guy came out, all right? And what I'm going to do here is, at this range, my reticle is not as sticky as it could be, okay? And what I mean by this is, when you're aiming at an enemy player, your reticle has this sticky effect on it. If you zoom in again, your reticle becomes even more sticky, allowing you to be more accurate as you whip your scope into place. So all I do is I zoom in here while I'm trying to shoot. Now, this isn't an optimal position to be in, and to be honest, you're going to see a lot of players who are warmed up. If they ever pull what I just pulled off, it's going to be when they're warmed up with a sniper rifle. I would take it much slower than that and not try to zoom in just to get the headshot. That can be not very advantageous. So this guy just backs up, and again, I'm just moving into this guy's head. This is not something where I'm necessarily whipping my scope into play. You can see me just moving very slowly. Notice how I'm following this guy with my body, okay? Notice how I'm following the same movement this guy is doing, and I'm just moving into the headshot. That's what I'm trying to do here, right? It's not some super advanced maneuver. Right here, I'm just kind of aiming at this head. Notice how now I'm zooming twice, and notice what immediately happens when I do so. I'm not able to move my reticle fast enough because I'm zooming twice, and he immediately jumps up and takes me out. I'm also not moving as much. And the reason why is because when you're so far zoomed in, if you move even a little bit, you see how fast I'm going from side to side? That's how fast you appear to be moving when you move from side to side. When you only zoom in a little bit, you're not moving as fast from side to side. So it encourages more strafing and moving, making you a harder target to hit and also making your shots in general more accurate because you can add your strafing from left to right into your aim. Good snipers always know that it's a combination of movement from left to right as well as aiming. You're not just standing in a general stagnant position. You're also moving from left to right, something I wish I would have known a long time ago in Halo 3 when it was very prevalent for that type of strategy. Halo 4, a lot of people, it's easier to whip scope in Halo 4 than any previous Halo game, and so many people have dropped or almost completely forgotten about the strategy of just moving into your opponent's head, which is what I'd suggest if you're a beginner sniper or just starting out and trying to get better. Right here, I know that guy is second, is weak, so I'm going to take him out. I get the triple kill here, and I see this other guy spawning, and I pick up that assisted kill from my teammate for the overkill. Really solid shots here as I get that overkill from machine gun turret. Now I can see this guy charging in, and I'm whip scoping right here. You can see how those shots are not really registering. And notice again how I'm whip scoping. I jumped up in the air and it's sort of whipping my scope around, and I'm not going to end up getting that kill, all right? Now, this is okay if you're in like a really tough situation, but once again, notice how I'm whipping my scope, okay? And how I whipped my scope. Those two shots did land, but they weren't headshots. It is pretty easy to whip scope into someone's body if they're already one shot. You don't want to be whip scoping if you know the person you're fighting is close to full shield or full shield, because you're going to be trying to get that headshot. Right there, I did get that headshot, and I'm kind of rashly pushing top center here, and I'm going to once again get killed from that same similar position, except this time it's going to be on the right-hand side of their base. They'll have two people looking at me from both their base ledges. And right here, we all have 30 kills remaining in the game. And I'm just trying to view people's heads and try to take them out here. I can see my teammate shooting on the right-hand side here. So I'm just watching for enemy spawns. Right here, I do pick up the bodyguard and the wingman, so I get 5 assists in a row, as well as saving 3 of my teammates in a row from enemy fire. Unfortunately here, as I pick up this kill for yet another rescuer medal, I believe, and a guardian angel saving my teammate from a long way, I do get taken out from the same general position. So now I spawn machine gun turret again, which is good. This is one of the reasons why you want to have your team all pushed up in this area. You don't want anyone sort of hanging back, because this type of thing can occur where your enemy players will spawn on your sides and they will kind of push up. You want to have a really solid line across the center of the map. And I know you don't want too many people on Pelican when you are blue team, like I said, but just one person would be great because he could call out players like this who are behind us now. As it is, we're kind of a little too far pushed up. And as you can see, my teammate just died top middle, probably from that player. So I'm just looking to the back of the enemy base. We've almost doubled the enemy team score here. And I'm just going to try to wrap with a few more thoughts. The gameplay kind of slows down. I'm just watching my angles, guys. I'm not trying to super hard push up like Jay Kudo, Star, and Mojo are doing. You're going to see that my stats and how well I did are reflected in the after game stats. You may think, oh, okay, you know, SNYP on top of their water cave right now, or, you know, Mojo or Kudo or Star are gonna get more kills because they're pushing up and actually seeing people. No, that's actually not true. And this is, while it's a slower part of the game, they're mainly pushing up because it's nearing the end of the game and maybe they haven't gotten as many kills. But I can promise you that hanging back like this is what's going to give you the most kills in matchmaking, especially if you're brutally consistent with the way you go with things. Now, right here, you're going to see me very much push up here. And I'd like to point out, once again, how I go about this kind of general strategy here. Now, I kind of whip scope, and unfortunately, thankfully, my teammate takes him out. I reload, and I'm just moving into his body. I'm not trying to whip my scope around, and this is literally how you no scope here. It is not something where you're going to whip your scope around. Notice how I'm not aiming at all. I aim to the right a little bit, and I'm aiming in front of the player where he's going to be. A lot of people don't do this. Yes, it's okay to follow the enemy player as he's going along, but more often than not, you're going to be aiming where the enemy player is going. That's why it's dangerous to jump like this to the side, because you're committing to a specific angle of movement. And I know this. I'm going to body shot this player, getting him no shields. Now, why this player doesn't back up is beyond me, as I end up coming around the corner and whipping my scope for that snapshot killjoy. Now, I hit this guy, and notice, once again, I'm going to slow this down very, very slowly for you, how I get this double kill. I do kind of whip the scope here, and that's because I'm warmed up, but I want you to notice where, in the last half second, where I place my reticle. Instead of just trying to whip my scope into his head, okay, I aim past him. Notice how I'm past him now. And all he's going to do, because he's along that trajectory of movement, okay, because I know he's going to jump up and go like this and then head back down, I'm aiming right here, which is exactly where his head has to cross, all right? And that's exactly what ends up happening. He crosses right into my path. And boom, I get the headshot as he snipes me as well. It is very possible to trade kills like this in snipers. I'm very glad it is, because the game is that precise in registering trigger pulls. I really like that. Three kills remaining here. I'm going to kind of push back to our side because I don't want to give up any unnecessary deaths. I see two people, and this is exactly what happens when your teammates have pushed into the enemy base. As you can see, they're spawning machine gun turret, like I said. Now, I don't get any kills here, but... guys, this wraps up the end of the game. Let's move on to the after-game stat screen, and I can sort of wrap up my thoughts on this style of play and why I think it's very beneficial to do this overall in matchmaking. So let's go to that stat screen. So looking at my stat screen here, you can see that I got 345 score, the most of my team, 21 kills, 2 assists, and 6 deaths. I'd like to point out that the assist spree that I got during the game is not triggered by pure kill assists. According to the description of the Wingman Medal, as it's called, it's not called an assist spree, it's called the Wingman Medal, it's get a spree of any 5 assist types. And any of the assist types medals are the assist, the vehicular destroy assist, wheelman, distraction, guardian angel, bodyguard, flying high, EMP assist, and road trip. Now, it is very strange because the rescuer medal is not a part of the assist support medals, and even the savior medal, where you save your king from being shot, or your VIP from being shot, is also not a part of these medals. So ironically, the main reason I got this medal was due to the bodyguard medal that I achieved from saving 3 of my teammates using guardian angels, and the guardian angels I achieved during the game by killing people from long range. The main thing I want to point out here is how I got the most kills while just holding a specific position of the map, not necessarily trying to push out. In most games, you're going to have to move around the map, especially on maps like Haven and maps of that nature. But on big maps, you can normally just control power position and use it to your advantage, as you saw me do here. Thank you for watching this video, and I'll see you guys in the next capture or whatever I end up recording. Carry the fire. Peace.